The Center for the Improvement of Human Functioning International presents this luncheon lecture. Today's topic, what really causes asthma, and what can you do to treat it? Your presenter, Ron Hunninghake, MD.
Phew, that was a lot. Well, that ends the lecture, no. Okay, welcome everyone. How many people in here have had an acute asthma attack where you suddenly felt like you couldn't get your breath? Yeah, several of you, yeah. I do not have asthma. I've had severe allergies, but I was body surfing with a friend in San Diego several years ago, and the wave picked me up and threw me down to the bottom of the ocean floor, and it completely knocked the breath out of me, and I really could not breathe for about 30 seconds, and I kept thinking, I'm going to die, and people are going to wonder what this guy's body surfing, and he dies of asphyxiation. But I know the fear. That was the first time that I'd really experienced the fear that I think goes along with an acute asthma attack, and it can be very, very dangerous. Status asthmaticus can kill. So today we're going to try to gain a little bit of altitude here on this problem of asthma and see if we can look at what's really causing asthma. And to do that, we have to kind of understand how the body handles itself in terms of injuries, because we're all exposed to injuries and stress. It's part of our everyday human experience. The good news is that we have a built-in repair system that we call inflammation. Now, I'm sure all of you are thinking, now wait a minute, inflammation is the bad guy here. Inflammation is what causes asthma, right? Isn't that the reason why steroids and steroid inhalers are used so much to try to knock this inflammation down? But yet, by the same token, without inflammation, we would never heal if we ever injured ourselves. It's actually quite a reliable thing. Most of us, if we cut ourselves, we don't get too shook up because we're pretty sure that it's going to go ahead and heal unless you're missing something really important. And so what happens in this process of inflammation? Well, of course, there's going to be pain and redness and swelling, and actually in the lungs with an asthma attack, there's not exactly pain, but there's swelling, and probably if you had someone look down with a bronchoscope, there's redness. And the reason this happens is that the inflammatory injury causes the release of a special little protein peptide called cytokines, and there's actually hundreds of these, and they act to signal, as a matter of fact, they're called cell signaling peptides. They signal for the white blood cells to come to the area of injury, and the white blood cells will actually go through the capillaries and slither out into the area that's inflamed, including the bronchial tubes. And if there's irritants there, if there's bacteria there, if there's something there that's triggering the inflammatory process, the white blood cells will work to take care of it. They'll scavenge away dead cells. They'll do what they need to do to seal the wound, to repair the injury, to heal that very process. And so if it weren't for good inflammation, we as a species wouldn't be here. Our survival has depended upon a good healing system. And so when we talk about unhealthy, bad inflammation, it's really not that inflammation itself is bad, it's that inflammation has gone out of balance. You actually want to have a healthy inflammatory system. What we normally think of as healthy is something that we can see. It's a visible phenomenon. Unhealthy inflammation, however, which I'm going to spend some time with here, is something that we don't see. It happens systemically. We don't realize that our body has kind of gotten out of balance. It's ready to, in a sense, capsize. But it's there as an underlying process that's causing wear and tear and undesirable effects in the body. And this is what I'm going to focus in on as the real cause of asthma. And not only asthma, really, just about any chronic disease that ends in the word itis. You're aware of arthritis, that's inflammation of the joints. Rhinitis is inflammation of the nasal passages. Asthma was named before we made this designation, but it could have been called asthmitis in the sense that our bronchitis, it's an inflammation of the bronchial tubes. Rhinitis, of course, is very common. Just watch your TV ads, and there's just lots and lots of antihistamines being advertised these days. Over 40 million sufferers, both allergic and non-allergic forms of rhinitis, and it's an unhealthy inflammation of the nasal passages. We want some inflammation. If you breathe in something that's an irritant, sneezing is a good thing. But if you can't stop, or if your nose continually runs, or if the reaction is out of proportion to the irritant, that's the unhealthy inflammation that we're talking about here. So asthma is inflammation of the bronchial tubes, very common. 17 million American sufferers. What is kind of interesting, it's sad, is that the incidence has been doubling since 1980. That there, for most of your medical authorities are wondering why. Why are we having so many more people struggling with asthma? Over 10% of children have some degree of asthma, and half of them have it beginning before the age of 3. It's the 7th ranking chronic illness. And this status asthmaticus, it can result in 5,000 plus deaths annually. So it can be a very serious problem. And less serious, but still a problem, is exercise-induced bronchospasm. How many of you have seen the basketball players and the soccer players taking their puff on the bronchodilator before the game because of bronchospasm due to exercise? Most of the time we think of the cause of asthma as the triggers for asthma. And there's a long list: tobacco, wood smoke, polluted air. And people are saying, well, this is the reason why there's so many more asthmatics, is because the air is more polluted. Perfumes, cleansing products, exposure to workplace irritants, molds, dust, animal danders, even things like dust mites. You may not realize, but every night your skin, you slough off just a little bit of microscopic skin, and there are microscopic dust mites that feed on that, and they can release things that can trigger allergic reactions. Even cockroaches can put out a certain antigen that can cause allergic reactions and allergies and asthma and bronchospasm. When you get the flu or an upper respiratory infection, that can be your trigger into an asthmatic attack. Cold weather or changes in the weather, extreme stress, or sometimes not even mild stress for some people will trigger them into an asthma attack. And I mentioned already physical exertion and exercise. Reflux, stomach acid coming up and irritating the back of your throat, getting down into the bronchial tubes, that can trigger it. Sulfites in wines, and in some women, menstruation can be a factor that can increase their likelihood of having an asthma attack. Well, you look through that list, who in this room isn't exposed to those triggers, right? And I didn't see everyone raise their hand. I'm sure you're here because you've got a family member or a friend, or you're interested in asthma, but not everyone has had an acute asthma attack. I haven't had an acute asthma attack. I've had some severe allergies, but we've all been exposed to those environmental triggers. So the question I'm going to ask all of you, why don't we all have asthma? Well, triggers are not the cause of asthma. Dust mites do not cause allergic rhinitis, but they can trigger it in certain people, susceptible people. So what sets you up for this predisposition is unhealthy inflammation. And so what I'm going to be focusing on today is why has asthma, the incidence of asthma, doubled in the last 20 years, 30 years? Why are certain people more subject to the ill effects of asthma than others? And I'm going to lay the cause at the feet of this imbalance in our inflammatory systems, that some people, your inflammation system is supposed to be your sentinel at the gate. It's supposed to protect you. But what if you have a trigger-happy sentinel? What if you have someone who's ready to fire at the slightest person that shows up? And that's what we've got. We've got a system that's overly sensitized, and it's doing damage as a result. So this whole phenomenon of unhealthy systemic inflammation sets the stage for all kinds of inflammatory diseases. You know, we've already mentioned allergic rhinitis. Did you know that one of the gastroenterologists in Salina, where I practiced for 10 years, used to call the fall his harvest, because he'd have a lot of people come in with ulcers, and he'd be scoping people and be very busy in the emergency room, GI bleeds. And it turns out that same time of the year, the excess histamine would cause ulcers and bleeding. And so GI inflammation can be a factor, reflux esophagitis. Just about everyone I know these days is taking some kind of acid blocker because of reflux esophagitis. Food sensitivities. We know here at the center that food sensitivities are almost a universal phenomenon. You only have to look around, and we know that obesity is on the rise, and obesity is associated with an increased risk of asthma. This past flu season, which we're kind of still in, has just been horrible. There's been so many people get ill and stay ill. So upper respiratory infections probably are there because your inflammatory system's not working as well as it should. And then, of course, asthma. So let's think about what is the mediator for the diseases, all the diseases of unhealthy inflammation. And now we're back to cytokines. Hopefully you'll start to feel more comfortable with this strange looking word, cytokines. Cyto means cell, and kinetics means action. So these are peptides that coordinate the actions of cells. They're cell signaling proteins. They can activate your macrophages, the natural killer cells, other immune cells to help your immune system. They're very pro-inflammatory, but they can be anti-inflammatory as well. Here's some names that you've maybe never seen: tumor necrosis factor alpha, interleukin-6, interleukin-1 beta. Actually, we are in our research department, we have a panel of 174 cytokines that we can now measure. So the whole understanding of cytokines is kind of exploding. And it's really useful information, because you can see how the body is coordinating these responses, and you can begin to take action to bring them under control. Leukotriene B4. We'll come back to leukotrienes in just a minute. Now, for those of you that go to your doctor and you say, gee, I've just heard about unhealthy inflammation, and this doctor says that, you know, you can have it and not know you have it, so what do you do? How would you find out whether or not you're a victim of unhealthy inflammation? Well, the C-reactive protein is another cytokine that can be measured in any doctor's office. It's a byproduct of interleukin-6. Your liver takes that and makes C-reactive protein. Interleukin-6 is thought to be the body's most potent pro-inflammatory cytokine. So if the liver is trying to dumb it down a little bit, you still know it's a very potent cytokine when you have an elevated C-reactive protein. And there's so many things that will elevate your CRP, such as arthritis, heart disease. We now know that the plaque that forms in heart disease has an inflammatory component. The cardiologists now are beginning to think of heart disease as a disease of inflammation. And your statin drugs, yes, they do lower cholesterol, but even in someone who does not have an elevated cholesterol, it can reduce the risk of heart disease simply because statin drugs are anti-inflammatory. Smoking is a very strong irritant, but it can elevate your cytokines. Syndrome X, which we talk a lot about here at the center, people who have pre-diabetes, their blood pressure's starting to go up, their lipid profile's looking pretty bad, they're starting to get some central obesity, their blood sugars are running a little bit high. This is all syndrome X, and it's due to insulin resistance, and it's associated with an elevated C-reactive protein. And then the next stage of that, of course, is full-blown diabetes, and diabetes is a disease of accelerated aging, a lot of serious complications. And we used to say that type 2 diabetes was adult onset. We even called it that. But now we can't call it anymore, because as the obesity phenomenon occurs in the United States and younger kids are becoming overweight earlier, we're finding out that young kids can develop type 2 diabetes due to insulin resistance, the same phenomenon. And our healthcare system is going to really start to, it already is staggering along, and these changes are not good. Alzheimer's has an inflammatory component, and you can see elevations in the CRP and the homocysteine level. And what we've found of very great interest is that cancer, active cancer, is associated with huge elevations in all of these cytokines because the body is gearing up extensively to try to fight the tumor. Psoriasis and other skin conditions, fibromyalgia, stroke, lupus, anemia, obesity, as I mentioned earlier, and even asthma. All of these things are related to imbalances in the cytokine system that is triggering unhealthy, so-called bad inflammation. So now we need to think about what's going on here. If it's not triggers that's the cause, because we're all exposed to triggers, then there must be some dysregulation of our system. We've already gone through the triggers. So what about inflammation regulators? I mentioned how inflammation, in a sense, is a kind of tripwire. And if you've got it strung too tight, the slightest little touch, and boom, you're into inflammation. If you've got it strung too loose, then you're not going to respond appropriately to challenges from the environment, and you're going to get sick and have a problem there. So really, you want to have a good balance between these two things. But what balances? What's the most powerful regulator of our inflammation system? I'm going to use an analogy here. Yes, food. This is. I have a little book that I did on inflammation, and in that, in order to kind of get this concept across, I use the analogy of the grass fire. And in this analogy, if you've got a field of grass, and if you think of sunshine as pro-inflammatory and rainfall as anti-inflammatory, if you have a nice balance of sunshine and rainfall, you'll have a nice field of green, lush grass, right? And if you take your trigger, which is your lighted match, and you throw it into the green grass, will it start the fire? Probably not. But what happens if you've got a drought and you've got too much sunshine and not enough rainfall, and the field dries out and it becomes brown, and now you take your trigger and throw it into the field, now you're going to get pro-inflammation. You're going to get a flame. You're going to get a big grass fire. And so this analogy kind of helps you understand that if we can balance things, we can control the tendency, the predisposition for unhealthy inflammation. And namely, what I'm basically saying is that unhealthy inflammation is the main reason why asthma has become such a big problem in our time. So, and to put this in a more scientific way, asthma is caused by an excess of pro-inflammatory regulators. To understand what these are, we need to look at what's happened to our diet. Now, I told you I was going to try to get a lot of altitude here, so I'm going to go back several thousands of years. You could almost say I'm going back several hundreds of thousands of years. And we're going to look at the history of diet and see if diet might have something to do with this. We're going to look at four major changes that have occurred to the way we eat. Our ancestors, and I don't know how far back you want to go, 3,000, 4,000, 5,000 years ago, our genes have not changed. Our genetic structure is pretty much unchanged from several, maybe 10, 20, 30, 40,000 years ago. So the ancestral diet is still kind of programmed into our genes. But then there was the agricultural revolution several hundred years ago, the industrial revolution, and in the last maybe, 40, 50 years, there's been the convenience fast food revolution. And let's look how this has changed our diet and how maybe this has something to do with the dysregulation of inflammation. So this ancestral diet actually has been studied pretty carefully. This Dr. Eaton from Emory University published a really wonderful article looking at a vast body of anthropologic and archaeologic evidence. He studied the records of 229 hunter-gatherer cultures, which is the way we think of our ancestors as hunter-gatherers. They moved around a lot. They hunted. They gathered their food. Well, 73% of those societies that he studied found that over half of their food came from animals and fish. So that should give us a clue that maybe protein is pretty important. But they also gathered a very large amount of plant matter, including leaves, roots, fruits, berries, seeds, and nuts. And so the vegetation, the fruits and vegetables, so to speak, were very prominent in the ancestral diet as well. And he showed that looking at the bone structure and the teeth and the various evidences that they could pick up, that our hunter-gatherer ancestors were generally healthier than we are today. Now they had to stave off saber-toothed tigers and other problems, you know, but in general they did not have the diseases of degeneration that our culture suffers from. They rarely experienced degenerative inflammatory disease that of the nature that I was talking about. Their cytokines tended to stay more balanced. So they ate about 19 to 35% of their calories from protein. They ate a lot more fat than what most people would think. You know, we went through this phase where we tried to make fat the bad guy, and I was just at a conference at University of California in Irvine and heard one of the doctors that was on the panel that established the guidelines for a healthy diet to prevent cancer. And I heard him say with his lips that we are no longer looking at fat as a cause for cancer, except for like trans fats. Now, so if you're eating whole foods and getting the right kinds of fats and not the added fats, fat is not the bad guy that we thought it was. But there was something very special about the ratio of omega-6 to 3 in the ancestral diet. It was a 1-to-1 ratio, 1-to-1. There was the same amount of omega-3 as there was omega-6. So we're gonna watch that as we go through these different historical shifts. And the further north you went, the higher the fat composition. The Eskimos, before they were westernized, did not even have words for depression and cancer and heart disease. They had 24 different words for snow, but they didn't have anything for degenerative diseases. They ate the balance of their calories from leaves, shoots, roots, fruits, seeds, and nuts. It was a very high fiber, high phytonutrient diet. Okay, and you can kind of get a sense for the antioxidant power of any food that you're eating. Now, by looking it up, you can look it up on the internet, and this is called the ORAC score, oxygen radical absorbance capacity. Doctors, researchers are measuring the antioxidant power of foods. Now, prunes and raisins come out especially good because they're dehydrated, and so it's concentrated the phytonutrients and the antioxidants, so they've got a little bit of an unfair advantage. If you looked at dried blueberries, they would show even higher than what they do. But nevertheless, these kinds of colorful fruits and vegetables have very high ORAC score, and that should give you a clue right there of where we should be kind of wanting to head. So the ancestral diet was very diverse. There was 100% whole foods. Our ancestors, they didn't have equipment to process the food in any way. They ate a lot of lean meats and fish. I mentioned they were high in protein, but it was a different kind of protein than what we get now. Our feedlot protein or our farm-fed fish, that's a different composition in the protein of that meat than what our ancestors eat. There was a lot more omega-3 in that meat. Of course, it had a very low glycemic index. There was a 1-to-1 ratio of omega-6 to 3, which is quite favorable, and large amounts of vegetable matter high in antioxidants and phytonutrients. So what we find now is that there are four measurable dietary factors that all of you can think about. You can go out and look at any food, and you can kind of assign these four measurable factors to any food, and these things we are finding have a huge impact upon the regulation of inflammation in the body. Percent wholeness, in other words, the meal that you're eating today, we would estimate is an 85 to 95% whole foods meal, which I tell people you don't have to be perfect, but if you can shoot for better than 40 to 50%, which is what the typical American eats now, you're going to be ahead because you're going to get a lot more nutritional factors as your wholeness goes up. The glycemic index, we want to keep it low, and I'm going to talk more about that. The omega-6 to 3 ratio, that can be easily measured in any food. And then the ORAC score, as I mentioned earlier, those numbers are now known. So if you put that together, that gives you a kind of a picture that I'm going to just call the inflammatory index of what you're eating. And now looking at the ancestral diet, they ate 100% whole food, a 1-to-1, 6-to-3 ratio, very low on the glycemic scale and very high on the ORAC scale. Now let's see what happens as we move through time and the hunter-gatherers settle down into agricultural type societies. Well, just that fact, they lost some of the diversity of what they were eating. You can grow quite a few things, but you can get a lot more if you're on the move and gathering as you go. The big thing is that farmers began to grow grains, and the ancestral diet didn't really have much grains in it, maybe a few here and there, but part of what farming is all about is growing something that you can store for the winter. And so there was a marked increase in grains, and grains are high in omega-6 fatty acids. And some of the grain is maybe fed to the domesticated animals. And of course, we're doing that big time now in feedlots. And so what happened is there was a pro-inflammatory shift in this 6-to-3 ratio. There was less vegetable matter, so the antioxidant, the ORAC score was down a little bit. And if you want to look at a society that represents this shift, it's the Egyptians. And we have really good records of what happened to their health because we can look at the mummies. There's thousands and thousands of mummies that have been studied. And what we find, what we find is that they had osteoporosis. They had heart disease. They had obesity. They had dental cavities. And so even just this relatively small shifts that occurred with the shift I've got down here, the shift from ancestral to agricultural, it had ramifications to their health. The diet was now about 90% whole because they could culture honey, they could bring in a few refined foods. Their omega 6 to 3 ratio went up to about 5-to-1 is the estimates. The glycemic index, because of more grains tend to trigger a higher blood sugar curve, and so that went from a high glycemic, from a low, very low glycemic index to maybe a medium or low medium. And then the ORAC score, because of the loss of all the phytonutrients and antioxidants, it went from very high to medium. So we're back now. We're going to talk a little bit now about this 6-to-3 ratio, because I think if you can go away with some key concepts here, you can begin to reduce your tendency for asthma. If that's the reason you came, what I'm showing you is things that you can begin to do in your own dietary choices to reduce your predisposition to not only asthma, but all of the unhealthy inflammatory illnesses that our culture is prone to. So key concept is this omega-6 to 3 ratio. Now most people, if you kind of look at why people eat what they eat, it's because They like to eat the way they were brought up. And so these cytokines, we know that cytokines regulate inflammation and that the fatty acids in your food are what regulates the cytokines. Well, what regulates the fatty acid ratios are your dietary choices, which, as I mentioned earlier, are largely a part of how you were brought up. And so the only way you can overcome that, I believe, is through a better understanding of what foods do to your body. Then you could make a choice to maybe not eat what you used to eat if you understand that certain foods are causing problems in your body. That's the best way. If someone tells you not to eat something, you know, we have a strong human need to be free, so we don't like for people to tell us what to do. But if we can discover it for ourselves and try it out and find out that we function better, then we're going to adopt that new behavior, even if we were raised differently. So looking at the power of fat, see the ancestral diet, it was 1-to-1 as we talked about earlier, so there's your balance. Remember I was talking about the inflammatory system needs to be balanced. This is a major balancing factor in the diet, is this ratio. And we saw how with the change to agriculture, that balance was shifted and there were consequences to that. And the reason that happened is that there's a higher amount of arachidonic acid associated with the omega-6 fatty acids, and we abbreviate that AA, and margarines and vegetable oils and a lot of the plant-based oils are almost exclusively omega-6 fats, whereas the omega-3, the fish oil, which I'm sure you've all heard about, there's a lot of research going on now in terms of the benefits of omega-3. And so what I'm going to show you is why. Why do these produce benefits? Well, and we get them from cold water fish or grass-fed animals. See, the farmers tend now to put their cows in feedlots, and they don't let them out and range feed as much as they used to. You can get some EPA and DHA from leafy green vegetables and from seeds as well. Where the rubber meets the road here are these two enzymes, the cyclooxygenase and lipooxygenase, or what we call LOX and COX. And these are what convert the omega-6, the arachidonic acid, into the pro-inflammatory cytokines, like the TNF-alpha and the IL-6. And so what we have is that the AA, the arachidonic acid, will compete with the omega-3 EPA and DHA for these enzymes. And the omega-3, if they get through, they tend to make the anti-inflammatory cytokines, like prostaglandins and the leukotrienes, okay? And whoever wins, it's just all a matter of numbers. If you've got a diet that is predominantly omega-6 compared to omega-3, just by sheer numbers, the arachidonic acid will fill up these enzymes and you'll get the conversion into the pro-inflammatory cytokines. Sheer competition. So in this case, the pro-inflammatory cytokine synthesis will exceed the anti-inflammatory cytokine synthesis. So your diet is what determines how this ratio turns out. And if you have eaten the wrong things, what you've done, it's too much sunshine and not enough rainfall, and your grass field is ready for the trigger. And the trigger is what lights the fire of asthma or whatever other chronic inflammation you want to talk about. Okay, let's shift now to the next big historical change that happened in the human diet, namely that of food processing due to the Industrial Revolution. This is where we began to use machines to change the very nature of the food that we eat. We didn't have much of this before, but now we did, and we could do it on a mass scale. And these processed foods became available at a low cost. So this was when we began to introduce margarine and separated fats. By the way, you know, back at the time of Osler, who is sometimes described the father of modern medicine, his first book of internal medicine only had one paragraph on heart attacks. Heart attacks were extremely rare. It was only after the introduction of margarines and separated fats and the changes that occurred with the Industrial Revolution that actually the incidence of heart disease began to rise. We also had the refining of grains, where you took out the fiber, you took out the germ, and all you were left with was just the white flour part of it. And then refined sugar became available very cheaply. So here we have three non-whole foods becoming available and entering into the food supply and having a dramatic effect upon the wholeness, and then several other effects as well. And what I call this is the displacement of nutrient-dense whole foods with nutrient-poor refined foods or refined calories, or what some people call naked calories. You know, sugar is a naked calorie, and I've been asking people, is that immoral for sugar to be naked? And I think it is. So greater risk of elevated blood sugar levels, which strongly shifts you in a pro-inflammatory direction. So now looking at this inflammatory index, where we're now into the industrial age, see how the percent wholeness has dropped further, and because we're refining the grains and taking out what little oils are there, and because we're feeding more refined things to the livestock, the omega 6 to 3 ratio has gone up even higher, and the refined grains are causing an even higher peak on the blood sugar curves. And the ORAC score, the antioxidant power of these foods, because we've been losing nutrients from them, that's low now. So we have a big shift. This glycemic index, a lot has been made of it. There was a group that took subjects and gave them foods and measured their blood sugar response. The problem is that it varies a little bit from individual to individual, but by averaging it, they kind of get an idea of which foods are high glycemic and which foods are low glycemic. Table sugar, white flour, potatoes, juices, the white foods that have been processed for the most part tend to be the high glycemic foods. In general, if you go for colorful foods, you're gonna go for a lower glycemic food that's gonna enter your bloodstream in a more even way and not trigger that big insulin burst, which can strain the pancreas and set you up for prediabetes. So the low glycemic foods are the colorful vegetables, whole fruits, dairy, and meat. These calories enter the bloodstream very slowly. They don't trigger the insulin, and so you tend to maintain a better overall balance within your body because insulin is pro-inflammatory too. So people who eat a lot of sugar, you can end up on a kind of a roller coaster ride where you'll have a high blood sugar, you'll put out too much insulin, and then you'll have low blood sugar, and now you're hungry again for something sweet. And so the ups and downs of blood sugar can leave people pretty exhausted, and that's a very common symptom in our culture today. The coffee stores are doing really well because people have low adrenal and they want that quick fix, and so they get the refined food and the coffee and the sugar to give them to get them out of the doldrums. But then over time, if you repeat this over and over again, it tends to wear out your adrenals, tends to make you a kind of a carb craver. And overall, the high insulin levels that this generates activates an enzyme which promotes the conversion of omega-6 to arachidonic acid. So we find that insulin itself is very pro-inflammatory. That's why diabetics tend to have an acceleration of the aging process. The sugar factor, in addition to the fact that sugar is a naked calorie, an empty calorie, what that does is that lowers the ORAC score of the food that you're eating. So you lose antioxidants, and so you're more prone to oxidative stress damage as a result. And to make things even worse, in recent times, we've taken the industrialization of food, and now we've made it convenient and fast. And unfortunately, it's dropped our wholeness even lower. It's made the omega-6 to 3 ratio even worse. The glycemic index is very high, and the ORAC score is very low. Now, I grew up, in the 50s. I mean, I was born in 51, and so I remember McDonald's was a big thing, and we loved to go to McDonald's. And, kids like McDonald's, the Happy Meal and everything. But from a food perspective, it's just not so happy in terms of this tendency towards inflammation, and that may be why so many young kids are even having problems with asthma and other infections and allergies and other problems. And so here we see widespread refining, processing, and manipulation of foods, very high refined carbohydrate intake. What is it, a 15-ounce thing of soda pop has, like, I think it's 17 teaspoons of sugar. Is that about right, Rebecca? Yeah, it's a very high amount. And then the hydrogenated trans fats, they're very pro-inflammatory. That gives everything longer shelf life, but they're very pro-inflammatory. They've been banned in certain states. If it weren't for potatoes in the French fries, our teenagers wouldn't be eating hardly any vegetables, but there's a very low intake of vegetables unless you get salads. You can go to a fast food place and make some intelligent choices, but you have to work at it. So asthma, I believe, is a modern dietary disease consequence. It's not to say that it's the only thing, but it sets the stage. And then all these other triggers that we talked about come in, and it makes it look like the triggers are what's the culprit. And if you go to your doctor, he'll spend a lot of time talking to you about triggers. But what I want you to think in terms of is regulators. And the most powerful regulator is diet. So if you look at kind of a side-by-side comparison, here's some of the foods that we were talking about on the pro-inflammatory side: vegetable oils, French fries and chips, fried chicken and fish, margarine, salad dressings, breads and pastas, microwavable foods, happy meals. See, this is your typical fast food alley right here. And it really sets you up for a lot of inflammation. But you can cook at home, you can go to special restaurants, use more olive oil as anti-inflammatory, cold water fish, fresh vegetables, low sugar fruits, free-range beef and chicken, game meats that's not corn-fed, and mineral water would be a good example or illustration of anti-inflammatory foods, kind of the Mediterranean diet. I just got back from Japan. The traditional Japanese diet definitely fits this. Man, they have over 3,000 different types of fish that they eat over there. So, and I cover all of this in a little book on inflammation. And my own levels after, you know, about 4 years ago, I just had terrible allergic rhinitis and found out that I did not have as good of a ratio of 6-to-3 ratio as I thought, and I've had to really work on getting that back under control, and it has paid off by reducing the allergies. So just in general, just to kind of wrap up the whole dietary thing, and then we're going to talk a little bit more about some other ways to treat asthma. You want to eat a variety of fresh and whole foods. Eat more fish, especially the cold water varieties. You're going to get more omega-3 than from freshwater fish. Grass-fed lean meats and game meats are going to give you more omega-3 and less of the undesirable things. If you can get them, they're more expensive. Lots of colorful vegetables are good for the antioxidants and the fiber. Use spices and herbs to flavor your foods. Turmeric and some of these really colorful herbs are highly anti-inflammatory. Olive oil is an omega-9 that you can use in your cooking that will help you reduce your level of inflammation. We found here at the center, by identifying and avoiding food allergens or food sensitivities, you can markedly reduce your level of inflammation in the body. Avoid conventional vegetable cooking oils. Avoid or limit your intake of refined sugars and refined grains. Limit dairy products. That's not true for everyone. I think the food testing will tell you if that's a big priority. Nuts and seeds are the new winners. Nuts and seeds will give you the omega-9 fats that are anti-inflammatory. They're rich in fiber. They're tasty. They're convenient. So we're emphasizing nuts and seeds. And when you're thirsty, try drinking water. And organically raised foods are good if you can afford them and they're easily available. Just to show you here, we have a computer software program that generates what goes actually into various meals. And this top meal is the happy meal, and the bottom meal is an example of a anti-inflammatory meal. And so you can see, just quick look, this is one recommended daily allowance of all the essential nutrients. And you can see there's a lot of gaps, a lot of spokes are missing in this particular wheel, which is the happy meal. Compare that to that anti-inflammatory meal, which has about 200 less calories, and you've got most of the spokes there. The ones that aren't there is sodium. You don't want a lot of sodium, and maybe not quite enough calcium in this particular meal. But otherwise, it does a very nice job of giving you the whole array of nutrients that your cells need in order to balance their functioning properly. Okay, I'm putting down here these pharmacologic strategies. This is kind of when you go to the doctor with asthma and you've got a lot of inflammation, you need some help. And I think acute care, you probably do need to use these medicines. But the medicines are not getting at the root of the problem, which is this imbalance that's creating unhealthy inflammation in your body. These things can all be utilized. They have their place. And I'm going to talk to you in just a minute about one simple thing that I've learned that can be very effective. It is a pharmacologic strategy. All of these other things we've already talked about, but they are some things that you can use in addition to the anti-inflammatory diet. Fish oil capsules, vitamin E, magnesium, quercetin, measuring your nutrient levels. The inflammation health panel can be real helpful for you figuring out what you specifically need as an individual. So these are some things that you can do to help yourself. What I'm going to talk about now is something that kind of happened. I went to a conference on environmental illness, and there was this family physician there named Dr. Philibert, not Dr. Phil, but Dr. Philibert, and he had discovered something about 15 years earlier. This was like 6 years ago, and he was injecting people with chronic pain, and he was injecting all over their back, wherever they had the pain, but several of the patients, 15 of them, came back and reported that they had relief from their asthma after they had their pain injections, which kind of intrigued him, and he kept good records, and he found out that all 15 of them had had their injection at a specific point on the scapula, both sides, and he called this point the infraspinatus respiratory reflex point, the ISRR. Infraspinatus is the muscle right below the spine of the scapula. And I encourage all of you, when we're done with the lecture, if you have a friend, have them check this point. If on the right scapula, this kind of looks like South America. It's where the Amazon is. Okay? Push around in there, and you'll find that there'll be a really hard knot there that's quite painful if you've got asthma or if you've got this infraspinatus point active in your system. So anyway, he began injecting these, and he found that he could do a really good job. And so he was teaching people how to do the injections. I learned how to do them. And so for the last 6 years, I've injected over about 500 patients now, or well, 500 injections using these particular points, and have found that it works amazingly well. And you'd say, well, why would that be the case? Well, this point is on the lung meridian. I really think that what Dr. Philibert has done, he's rediscovered acupuncture in a kind of Western way. And the way he talks about it is that the gallbladder, if you have a gallbladder attack, very often it'll hurt below your right shoulder blade. That's a reflex connection. Well, he believes there's a reflex connection between this ISRR point and your bronchial tubes. And if this muscle back here, this infraspinatus muscle, is in spasm and like a knot, and that's the way I feel it when I check people, that sends increased sympathetic tone to the bronchial tubes, and they tend to be tight. They tend to be really constricted. And when we inject that point, it relieves the spasm, and as the spasm lets up, then the wheezing will actually let up. So people will come into the office wheezing and walk out not wheezing. And for chronic bronchitis or chronic asthma, by repeating this, you can just gradually make the asthma go away for the really severe asthmatics. The injection is relatively painless. All the Hunninghake kids had problems with exercise-induced bronchospasm. They were big soccer family, and so they've all been injected, and they request it. I mean, you know, kids requesting an injection, you know right there, it's not too bad. And so it's very safe because the scapula is a bone. And so when you inject into this muscle, even if you were to inject too far, you're never going to inject into the lung. You would never accidentally poke the lung and cause a pneumothorax because the bone is underneath the muscle. So it's a very safe injection from that perspective as well. The stuff that you use is the same thing you would get at your dentist's office, 0.5% lidocaine, and then you would, if you went to the orthopedic doctor for a shoulder pain and had a cortisone injection, he might give you 2 cc's of celestone into your arm or wherever the point was hurting. Well, this injection only uses 0.15. It's probably 1/15. Of what an orthopedic doctor would use for just a normal trigger point injection. So it's not very much. And the reason that Dr. Philibert puts that in is that by using that little bit of steroid, it reduces the inflammation in the muscle so it doesn't spasm back down again after the lidocaine wears off. So this injection will hold most people for about 2 weeks and sometimes 2 months. It just varies from individual to individual. And so the actual injection is I have the patient just sit up on a chair or on the exam table, and they take off their shirt, and we find this point, which is about right here. There's a kind of a little soft spot right here, and if you feel around with your thumb, you can find a hard muscle knot, and then about 4 cc's of the combination is injected longitudinally, and then the syringe is turned. And then there's a kind of a deep phase to the injection. And the other 4 cc's are injected. Very well tolerated. Takes about 20 seconds for each injection to be done. It can be done very quickly. Then I go over and do the other side, and then we're done. The patient leaves, and very often on their way home, they notice that they can breathe. The air just moves in a lot easier. May need to repeat this every couple weeks if they have severe asthma. Some patients require very few injections. It can open the bronchioles that are spasming. It reduces the sympathetic tone. You can do acupressure on your friends and family, and it helps to a degree, but it's not as good as the injection. Quick case study of this, I have a 16-year-old female who had an 8-year history of asthma. She described it as severe, unrelenting asthma, cough, allergies, fatigue, and headache. And in January of 06, she had a very bad flare, which required high doses of prednisone. She was very unhappy. She's, you know, a teenager, and her acne, the prednisone made her acne much worse. She gained a lot of weight, and her face was quite swollen from the steroid. And the worst of it was, the doctor says, you can't play your sports. And she was a real athlete, so she had to give up her basketball, baseball, and soccer. And as you can see, she was on a lot of medications. This Xolair injection, she had to get, it's a $3,600 shot every 2 weeks because her asthma was so bad. Plus, she had done allergy testing and was getting the allergy shots. She was doing everything she could to try to get her asthma under control and just not quite getting there. And so she came to us, and of course, we don't just do a shot. You know, we try to work up the whole patient. We look at nutrient levels. We talk to them about their diet. We did food sensitivity testing on her. Some of the things that we found is that she was very low in vitamin C. All of her vitamins were in the 10th percentile, so she had poor absorption. She had a high copper, which is not unusual in kids, not enough zinc. Elevated CRP, elevated candida, very low EPA, DHA, and GLA. So in other words, the omega-3 was low. Her arachidonic acid was high. So remember I said a 20-to-1 ratio is what the modern fast food diet is doing. Her ratio was 38.7-to-1. So she was very shifted in a pro-inflammatory direction. And so what I put down here are the various times that she's come for her injections. And so this was the very first one that we did back in November of 06. And I should tell you, I put this down here, she lives in Woodward, Oklahoma, so it's a 4.5-hour drive, just one way to come here to see me and to have this injection. So she had had her second flare before we had a chance to start treating her. And so this was her first injection. And then even after that first one, she came back saying that she was a little bit better and she was having to use her nebulizer less. And then by the third time she came in for her injection, she was off the Advair and completely off the nebulizer. The fourth time she was better. Fifth time she was back playing soccer again without wheezing. This time she was completely off her prednisone and the swelling had gone away. Here she was went to soccer camp that summer, you know, summer dusty camp, and she handled it fine. And these last two times, she was just not having any problems at all. She still uses some of her medicines. I haven't tried to tell her that she has to stop all of her medicines, but she has made this drive now, whatever that is, 9 times just to have these injections because she has found so much help from the injections. So the reason I'm mentioning it is a modality that I think is effective at helping people with chronic asthma, and it does highlight the fact that it's an inflammatory illness. But what Dr. Philibert says is you're putting the steroid right where the inflammation is, and you don't need to expose the patient to systemic steroids in order to control that localized inflammation. So in summary, for the whole lecture today, what we've been talking about is that inflammation really is a good guy. It's supposed to be protective, but if it gets out of balance, it becomes destructive. And what we find is that this problem is on the rise, silently on the rise. And of course, the reason we think is because of an imbalance in the dietary regulators that are shifting people in a pro-inflammatory direction. Of course, there are genetic predispositions. There's a number of reasons why some people are going to get asthma and some people are going to get arthritis. But the underlying cause is the shift towards inflammation. Aging and asthma and all of these chronic illnesses are accelerated by unhealthy inflammation. The triggers set the pro-inflammatory predisposition on fire. But if you choose the right kinds of dietary regulators, similar to what our ancestors ate, you can actually begin to reduce your inflammation tendency. And that's what this young lady from Oklahoma had done. So, okay, with that, I'm going to go ahead and take some questions. We got a microphone, and you know, raise your hand, and we'll bring the microphone. Doctor, yes, go ahead.
On this girl from Woodward, her last two visits, it says no problems and no wheezing. So why did she come in for the injection?
Well, she's thinking of it as preventative at this point. She's the goalie for the soccer team. and she does not want to get back to where she was. And so part of the other reason is her mom drags her in too, you know, that's, but the mom has just seen her suffer so much because, you know, this is an 8-year history of really severe asthma that I think they see this has really made a big difference for her, and so they're trying to stay ahead of it. And so when she comes in, she's not wheezing, so it's prophylactic at this point.
Dr. Ron?
Yes.
I've got a question here from Renee Olmsted in Colorado Springs that's watching it online.
Wow, how about that?
And she wanted to know if there were any chiropractic procedures or remedies that might work with asthma as well.
I'm sure there are. I don't know if Dr. Carrier is here, but you know, they're definitely, because this point is in the upper back area, I'm sure there could be some kind of an adjustment that would also be helpful. So I would definitely encourage people that if they're finding help with this, that they would do good to see the chiropractor as well.
Good question. I'm just wondering, does climate come into this at all? I just talked to my daughter, and that's why I'm here, because she had asthma, but she's lived in Washington State for 2 years now. And the other night I called her, and she told me she's not used her inhaler for a year up there. And when she lived here, she was using it quite a bit.
Yeah.
Do you think that's her diet up there, or could climate be affecting it?
What do you know? Has she changed her diet? Do you know?
No, she's always been a good eater. That's what surprised me about this. She's the one that makes, you know, the whole foods and so forth of everybody in our family. She's the better eater.
Would you ask her the next time you talk with her if she's eating more fish? Because my daughter went to school up there for a year, and she told me she started eating a lot more fish up in the Seattle area, because it's more common and more available up there than it is here in the Midwest. And there may be a factor with the types of allergens. You know, some people react to one set of allergens and they move out of that region and they're not as reactive to the other types of allergens, though it's pretty moldy and damp up there too. So, but yeah, I think climate can certainly play a role, but I'd be suspicious of a dietary change for the better.
The preceding program was presented by the Center for the Improvement of Human Functioning International and the Bright Spot for Health Lunch and Lecture Series. To inquire about additional health-related information available on DVD, audio CD, VHS, or audio cassette, simply call 316-682-3100 or drop by 3100 North Hillside in Wichita, Kansas. To discover more about the center and what we have to offer, be sure and visit us on the web at www.brightspot.org.